Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Rebecca Hall Gruyter and Andy Young here. Rebecca is a global influencer and number one international best-selling author, and Andy Young is the author of Fight or Flight, Negotiating Crisis on the Front Line. So we're going to talk about global influence and frontline crisis prevention and handling all kinds of negotiating. So it's going to be fascinating. I hope you stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Rebecca Hall Gruyter, who is a global influencer, number one international best-selling and award-winning author and compiler, an in-demand publisher and empowering radio show host, where she reaches over 1 million listeners on 8 networks, and she's an empowerment leader. She's done a lot of different things, which sounds like somebody I know, and that sounds like we'll have a lot in common. So it's so nice to have you on the show, Rebecca.
Oh, thank you. I'm thrilled to be here. Looking forward to the conversation. Thank you for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. And I know we've been talking back and forth about being on each other's shows. We both do similar things, you know, in some respects, in the fact that we have shows. But you deal with helping highlight experts, influencers, messengers, you know, and so on. I want to get a little background on how you even got interested in that. Can you just give me your backstory a little bit?
Sure. Mm-hmm. And why I believe visibility is so important and why we really align with experts and influencers and help them reach more people has to do with some of my journey. And if we go back in time, I grew up in a very unsafe, dysfunctional type of environment. And the people who should have cared for me didn't. And in that environment, when I cried out for help, it wasn't believed and it became more severe. And so I took on certain beliefs. I believed I didn't matter, that I'm not okay, that there's something wrong with me that's causing this, that I'm unlovable. And absolutely, it was not safe to be seen or heard. Wow. So I learned to act like everything was okay, smile really big, but I was the little girl that never wanted to go home and had sad eyes.
Oh, that's
I got
really
rescued. It was. And I really internalized those beliefs. And eventually I was rescued, for which I'm really, really grateful for. And I got to go on a healing journey and discovered that those beliefs were actually not true, that I was lovable, that I had value, I mattered, that it was safe to be seen and heard. And that was the hardest part of the journey for me, to really take it from knowledge, because I think we know a lot of things.
Right.
To embodying it, believing it, really owning it, and truly stepping forward to be seen and heard. So if we fast forward to stepping into this space and the empowerment space, the transformational space, it was still something I was struggling with. I was good at putting up a good front. I learned how to hide in the public eye, actually. You can do that too.
Oh, yeah.
You show up a certain way, hair, certain way, you know, all of that. Mm-hmm. And I discovered that if I wanted to make the difference that was on my heart to make, I had to be willing to be vulnerable. I had to take that shield down because it actually wasn't protecting me. It was keeping people from me. And I wasn't able to really touch their hearts or connect on that level because I wasn't willing to open my heart up and be willing to lead that connection. So as I discovered how to do that, I learned something else about visibility. I had a huge heart. I want to make a positive difference for my passing there. I want to leave the world better than I found it for the sphere of influence, whatever size it is that I'm given. I want to be a positive. I want to have a positive impact. And I discovered nobody knows if you don't tell them. If they can't see you, if they can't hear you, it's not by osmosis. Somehow they know that they matter. Somehow they know what you do and how you can help them. And so what I discovered visibility is about, it's being really easy to find by the people who need you most.
That's interesting. Now, when you say that, I'm looking at some of the pictures on your website. I see that there's a lot of women in this one couple of pictures that you have at the top of your site. Do you deal mostly with women, or is it a combination of people?
It's a combination. So as a speaker, I tend to be an influencer in the women's empowerment space. Mm-hmm. So if people are looking to have me speak or share or serve, that's where I'm called as an individual. As an organization, we support both men and women to show up powerfully and be easy to find in different types of media, from radio to TV to podcast to just a whole rip books, a whole range of things, and support both men and women in doing that.
Well, you know, you do a lot of similar things in the fact that you have a radio show and, you know, you're an author and all the things. And I think that a lot of people now are trying to get noticed. So they write a book, because everybody's got a book. So you have to have a book. That's a new business card. And then they want to have a podcast, because that's another way to get a platform. And everybody wants a platform, of course, to get noticed. Anybody who's ever tried to get a publisher, that's a word you're going to hear really soon, right? What's your platform? And platforms, really, how many people follow you and how are they following you, right? So what do you think is the most important platform? Is it social media? Is it a book? Is it a radio show? Or is it just you have to have all of the above? What do you tell people?
The more platforms you have that you are using effectively, the better. I don't believe it's just checking things off the list and let's be here. Mm-hmm. You can have a million platforms, but if you're not using them effectively for your goals, it's not going to help you. So if you're going to do a podcast, wonderful. It's a great way to reach people, but have a strategy around it, a purpose. Know who your people are that you're trying to reach. And are they people that listen or watch podcasts? You want to go back to who the people are that you're trying to reach.
Right.
Is that platform an effective way to do that first? And then how are you using the platform? Are you looking to grow your list? Are you looking to monetize things? Are you looking to expand how you're positioned and seen in the world? Are you wanting to bring great information, provide services? What are your goals around that? And it's the same thing with books. It's the same thing as a speaker. What is that next step? Do you have a next step that you're sharing with people, making it easy for them to know to take that step? Or do they have to kind of guess and figure out what that next step could be? Hiring you as a speaker or a coach or a consultant? What are those pieces that you are bringing forward? And is that platform you're choosing an effective way to connect, be positioned, take those next steps?
Well, you know, you bring up a really important point, because I think, you know, there's a lot of social media places to be seen, and maybe TikTok's not the best place, or it won't be when this airs, of course, but because they're getting rid of it. But, you know, you want to be, for me, my people, my base would be more on LinkedIn. And, you know, so to spend a lot of time on Instagram might not do as much for me as being on LinkedIn. But, you know, there's a sense for me when I get out there that, you know, there's all these people doing the same things. There's so much content. They give people just some free stuff, and you know, then they'll want to come back to your site. Don't ask them for anything. Give, and all this stuff. But it seems like there's a lot of sellers without a lot of buyers in this market. Everybody is just selling to each other. It's almost like if you join you know, any local networking events where you guys get together and you realize that you're all real estate agents and nobody's buying houses or whatever it is, right? Is it like that a lot in social media?
It can be. There's a lot of summits that can be structured like that, a lot of programs that are being opened up like that. But part of how I believe you stand out is being really clear on who your people are and really clear on what you're bringing to them mm-hmm. that is unique and different for their particular needs. I think that's really important. You do want to have a presence in social media, very important, but right. choosing the social media or social medias that are going to connect you with the people you're trying to reach is important.
Yeah.
Just checking the box and being on all of them. And in social media, here's an important thought for people. So often we do output only. We're treating it like a place to post, to share, and sell, like you're saying. We just send information out. We're actually not watching and monitoring and responding.
Right, that's important.
And that's actually a platform where you can create engagement and build rapport and relationships. It's not just output only. You want to make sure you're responding, you're building that rapport and building those relationships.
And I think, you know, that's interesting because, you know, when I started this radio show, it was just for me interesting to learn from people. That was it. But I think a lot of people have an ulterior motive, you know, when they do things. This is, I'm going to get CEOs on and I can get business, or I, you know, could speak from who I talk to on the show. And if you're doing it for that reason, it's going to come across really clearly that you've got a, you know, a ulterior motive. So I think, though, that there's this two-way communication that sometimes I see gets kind of faked. You know what I mean? Like some people are like liking everything, trying to get their, you know, or tagging you and everything because they think that you're an influencer. So if you're a global influencer, you must get tagged a lot because they go, well, everybody's following Rebecca. I want people to see my message. How do we get people to not think like that?
Well, some of that I think comes from a scarcity place. Mm-hmm. Or a place of, I'm not enough. Mm-hmm. There's other ways that you can engage in a conversation with people and share out. People do tag. People will do that. And it's okay. You can monitor the tags, untag, take your name off. You can do those.
Uh-huh. I mean, it's nice to be tagged on some things, but some people do it too much, right?
Yeah, yeah. And just kind of watching that. So, again, you want to watch what's happening in social media, not just schedule it and forget it. And I think sometimes that can happen. It is an ongoing relationship, an ongoing conversation, and monitoring that, paying attention to that. If somebody's abusing it, you can send them a message and just ask them not to if you have that kind of a relationship. Or can you tag me on these things? Or here is the direction on that, or give them a little guidance. Or you can just untag and monitor and block if it gets to that level. I find people generally aren't abusing that. It's rare where I find that happens. I feel more are really coming from a place they're just really trying to reach their people.
And
get the word out. And I'm fine with supporting that, but it may or may not reshare those out because it depends on the relationship that I have with those people.
Yeah, and I know you develop a lot of relationships because you do in-demand publishing, you do all these different things. And as I said, a lot of people want to have a book. And I think it's good to have a book if you show you have an expertise in a certain area. But you say not to just, you know, publish your book. You have to launch it. So what do you mean by that?
Oh, when just I'll give a little example
of
what that means. So when I first entered the industry as a speaker, I had an opportunity to be part of a couple of book projects, and they were anthologies, which are a book compilation with multiple authors each contributing a section. And that felt much less intimidating to me than writing a whole book. So I decided to do that. And I was aligned with other authors and experts. And I felt I could learn a little bit about this whole publishing thing, what it means, how it works. So that's the step I took. And I participated in two different anthologies that ended up coming out almost at the same time. I don't know if I would recommend that, but that's what I did. Both quality publishers, great authors that I got to be with and positioned with, great communities. All of that was really good. one of the books just released. And that's typically what happens in the publishing world. The book is released. Mm-hmm. That means it is now available for purchase. It doesn't mean there's any promotion around it. That typically falls on the author. And with this particular book, I was so new in the industry, I didn't quite know what to do with it. I was a little bit shy being a published author and not quite sure what to do with it new right. in the industry. And I still have those books on my shelf in the garage. And they're great books, but they're not serving by living in the garage.
Right.
The other book was launched. So very similar type of content, great people in it, but they made it a big deal. They had a whole launching campaign, all this visibility. There's an opportunity to be at a conference, sign books. It became a number one international bestseller in multiple categories and countries. And what it did for me is it created an opportunity to expand from a local, regional visibility to an international
right.
very, very quickly. And I caught the eyes and the showed up on the radar of Voice America on the radio side, which is a global network that has live broadcasting shows. And they recognized that I had a platform. I'm still figuring that out myself. I had something that I stood for. And it was around women's empowerment. So they wanted my voice and my message on their network. So that opened up an opportunity in radio, which led to television, which led to having my own television show, then channel, then network. I got to be the network director for a while on the women's channel, TV and radio. Ended up having my own network and led to a lot of other opportunities in the speaking world. So the second book that had that visibility component where they launched the book mm-hmm. changed the course of my career and life. It made a huge impact. Those books are out there serving people in their hands and hearts and continues to open up doors.
Well, tell me, what if somebody's listening, they think, I want to launch my book. What do you mean by launch exactly, other than book signings and the things that they might be thinking of initially?
So it's really important when you are either self-publishing, working with a publisher, have a conversation about what happens once the book's released. What is their plan to get the message out there? How will people know about how amazing this book is? How do I get it in front of people? That's really important.
Can you give examples?
Yeah. So for us, when we do a launch, we use a multimedia approach. So there's radio interviews, there's podcast interviews, magazine write-ups. We're trying to position the author as the spokesperson of their message. So they're increasing their visibility while they're bringing their book forward and making it a bestseller. So we give them a lot of visibility in social media, on those different media platforms, so they can really be seen and heard as the expert they are. That leads to a lot of doors opening up. And then on top of that, it creates enough momentum that we're able to get their book as rated as a bestseller or above on Amazon. That's the platform that we use. So that gives them great positioning so that every print book will have that ribbon on it. So they have instant positioning, every person who looks at their book going forward. Plus, they got all this great visibility when their book was released and launched.
Well, you mentioned getting on television shows, and I've been on other shows and done certain things. I've never had my own television show other than, you know, the YouTube kinds of things that people mm-hmm. have. Tell me a little bit about your television show and what that did for you.
Sure. And it is on the more of a internet-based network, so it's not on the other types of platforms. But it created a lot of visibility, and when people can see you, you have an additional connection on top of hearing you. So being on those types of platforms, when it's on a network, and YouTube is fabulous. I love YouTube, but you can have squirrel videos on YouTube.
Yeah.
So it doesn't, it's a great place to be, but you don't always have a lot of control of the type of other content that can be around you. And how that's positioned. And when you're on the network, there's typically they don't take everybody, so there's a little bit more control out of what is positioned around you, which also helps position you. So there's kind of a level that you need to be seen and heard at to be able to have an opportunity on that network. So it's good positioning for you.
Yeah, you know, this is an interesting thing, you know, because I've been with on some of Jeff Hazlett's stuff. He's got C-Suite TV and different aspects, and I did my book trailer with his, you know, C-Suite book launching group. And it is interesting to see the power behind different platforms and what they can offer. And I know I've talked to Voice America, and I've been on a lot of Voice America shows, and yours is one that I'm going to be on, and different things like that. I think that there's so many ways that we can get out there and get known. But I think a lot of it is what you're saying when you're out there and when people are interviewing you. And I think it's important, anybody here who's thinking of launching their book, I guess I'm working with Dr. Gilda, who used to be on Sally Jesse Raphael. She's a very well-known personality in the field of human relationships. We were working on a media program together about, you know, helping people know how to get their message really resonating on television and on podcasts and different things. What advice would you give to people who are launching their book or their whatever their product is that they're trying to get known for, of the kinds of things that they should be saying on the air? Sometimes you've got, I know I go on a local television show here, 4 minutes is a huge amount of time. You might get three, you know. What do you advice do you say for those people?
So a few things I would say. One, be part of sharing the message out. Let people know that you're going to be on the show. Mm-hmm. Build that excitement and that buzz. Mm-hmm. Share the replay out. Be visible. Tag the players that are part of it. They're going to watch and notice that, and they pay attention to people that are participating in helping get the word out. You want to have some things prepared in bullet point format. Less is more. So, for example, I could say life is not a solo journey, which means it's a myth. Sometimes people think you have to do everything on your own. It's not true. We can let people in and we can go further when we do, because life is not a solo journey. So I said it twice. I expanded on it, and it was very short as a core message that I could bring forward. You want to have things like that that are short, that are in alignment with the messages you're wanting to bring forward. Great to tie it into what your book is about or whatever you're bringing forward.
Right.
But you want to have some short bullet points that are repeatable, tweetable, and people will hear and start to associate with you to leverage those platforms.
You know, it's kind of challenging. You know, I think it's kind of fun being on some of the local television shows, because you just never know what they're going to ask you. And I prefer that. I don't know about you, but I don't like it when I know exactly what they're going to ask me. I think, because then you start getting like this memorized what you want to say thing. I prefer to think on my feet, but other people maybe don't. What do you tell people to help them be prepared?
Well, you want to be prepared to kind of go any direction and really know that you're an expert in what you do.
Yeah.
And you don't have to answer every question that is asked.
Right. You can sort of say, hey, that's a good point, but look over here, right? I mean, just because.
Well, exactly. Or you can just, I actually don't share that. And I've done that. And I said, I don't share that. And they'll say, well, why don't you? And then I can tell them why.
Yeah.
And then go into what we do share and want to bring forward. So know where your boundaries are. Just because someone asks doesn't mean you have to answer it that way. And you can do the shiny object. Oh, yes, great question. Look over here. It's a conversation.
See my keys.
Controlling the conversation. I think.
Say that again.
Sometimes people as guests try to control the conversation because they have an agenda.
Right.
Of where they're trying to go, or they're nervous, and that comes across, and it doesn't let the host showcase you strongly or help you shine if you're trying to predict where things are going or have it go a certain direction. Really trust the platform you're on, but do your research. You know, not every show perhaps is the right show for you, but remember, you are in control of your message and what you're bringing forward. You're the spokesperson for what you stand for and what you're bringing forward.
Yeah, you bring up a great point about, you know, if you're going to pitch your idea to shows, you know, I've gone to different programs where they try to tell you the types of things to pitch. And, you know, I like to learn from just everybody. And when I was new at all that, I listened to some of these people and they'd say, have this one sheet that says this and says that. And some of it, as now that I've interviewed more than 1,000 people on my show, I look at what they were teaching and I was like, no, that's not at all what I want to see. So I think it's interesting to know how to pitch yourself and where to look. For me, it's really important that somebody gives me a really good bio and good. I love it when they provide questions, just because I don't really necessarily read those questions, you know, on the show. But it tells me which direction, what they have in mind, what they like to talk about, what they're good at. I think it also helps to have like clips of things that you've done, you know, videos that people could watch, or you know, just I see so many people. I'll have people send me their CV or resume. I'm like, no, don't. That doesn't. I'm glad you did that, but it doesn't help for the show host. So, you know, when you're pitching yourself, like you said, you want to make sure you're a good fit for the show. Do you think that people just spam all the top names they hear and don't even look at their shows? I mean, how much research should they do?
Frequently, that's the case, or they have their people doing that.
Right. It seems more like their people. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's almost like they're cold calling shows. Mm-hmm. And they haven't researched the show. They haven't even followed that person. And sometimes they're not giving a lot of lead time for when they're wanting to be on a show. And if a show is a popular show, you need to plan out 2 to 3 months sometimes at a time.
At least, yeah, sometimes. Uh-huh.
Yeah, to get in the cycle there, if you have things that are time sensitive that you're wanting to launch and share, and follow whatever process you're given. If you're asking to be on their show and their platform, that's an honor and a privilege and an opportunity for you to be lifted up. So follow whatever process you're given to get your information in. So if you have to fill out this form and then you have to send that in, do that. That's just part of the process. And it helps the host and whatever platform they're on help you shine and be seen and heard and how things are structured there. So really be willing to do what they need you to do so they can build the show effectively with the lead times needed, with the types of materials they ask for. And a one-time speaker sheet or speaker reel is not enough for what they need to determine if it's a good fit, and then the pieces they need to build the show out.
Yeah, and I think that's really important. And I know we touched on the fact that you do this publishing and all mm-hmm. the in-demand publishing. And I know we've only got a minute or so left here. I just want to hear a little bit about what you'd want people to know about what you can help them do to release their books in the world and how they could reach you.
Absolutely. So we specialize in helping experts and influencers that want to launch their books, not just release the book. They're wanting to launch the book, really have a full-scale campaign built around them so they can be positioned as an expert while they're bringing their book forward and achieve that best-selling status. And that's really what we specialize in. And it can be combined with our publishing services, or it can be a standalone that perhaps they have the publishing taken care of, but they want that campaign piece. And so we're able to build that around and help get them to that place very quickly. So we love helping people do that. We want to help you reach all the people that need your message and position you at the same time. So that's what we do in the publishing space. And for those of you who want to connect in, we'd absolutely love that. Our website is yourpurposedrivenpractice.com. That holds everything. Mm-hmm. Yourpurposedrivenpractice.com. And there's a button you can click to learn more, as well as reach out and have a conversation.
Well, this has been so great, Rebecca. I knew we'd have a lot to talk about because this is all really fascinating to me. I love this whole field, and I really appreciate you sharing your successes and how other people can do something similar. So I really appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for having me today.
Oh, you're welcome. And we will be back right after this message. Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com. I am here with Dr. Andy Young, who's been a professor of psychology and counseling at Lubbock Christian University since 1996, and a negotiator and psychological consultant with the Lubbock Police Department SWAT team since 2000. He is also the author of different books. I think the one that we're going to talk about today is, I'm very excited about, is A Fight or Flight, Negotiating Crisis on the Front Line. So, Andy, it's so nice of you to join me on the show.
Oh, it's a pleasure being here. Thank you very much.
Oh, well, you're welcome. And I know you also wrote When Every Word Counts, An Insider's View of Crisis Negotiations. You've published all kinds of research. I'm really fascinated in the overlap between, you've got your degree in psychology, I have mine in business. Well, you actually have your education degree. And then we're talking about psychology-based things, which is really fascinating, mm-hmm. because I think this kind of all overlaps. So I kind of want to get a background on you to see, you know, what got you interested in psychology and what and negotiation and all that aspect if you started out in education.
Yes. Well, what got me interested was early on, people just naturally seemed to talk to me and talk to me about their problems. And when I went to college, I was like, well, I probably need to be better equipped to respond to people. Uh-huh. So I got an undergraduate degree in ministry with a minor in psychology and eventually got a master's in counseling and got my teaching job here at the university. And the university said, well, if you want to keep your teaching job, you need to get a doctorate. So I got a doctorate in counselor education, which is teaching people how to counsel.
Wow. Uh-huh.
While I was working on my master's, the chief of police secretary came to me and said, hey, would you like to become part of the patrol division of the police department? The chief is sick of sending his officers to the same domestic dispute over and over again. There's no arrestable offense there. So the chief wants to get you psychology types out here on the street and in these houses so his officers can go catch bad guys and you can help these people so they don't keep calling 911. So my interest in this, it really came and found me, and I ended up kind of learning on the fly because though a background in counseling and psychology was helpful, a little more was needed once it got out on the street.
Right. Real world experience is a little bit different than we were.
Exactly.
The textbooks we have in school. And it's a fascinating thing because a lot of people think I have a degree in psychology, but mine's actually in business. But I wrote my doctoral dissertation on emotional intelligence and its impact performance. So that's the same basic, dissertation you could write for a psychology degree as well. And it's funny to see how these things overlap. And you
exactly.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is the real world experience that you get from what you've researched. And I've done a lot of peer-reviewed scholarly research, as you have. And it's a fascinating look at how we learn things, I think. Yeah. But you're talking about some of the things that you really only find out in the field. I mean, you know, you can read about domestic disputes, but until you're dead in the middle of them, right? It's
exactly.
Not exactly the same. Now, aren't those supposed to be the most dangerous for police officers? And do you get right in the middle of these times where, like, they're at the tough times, or when are you involved?
Yeah, with the patrol response, an officer will show up and, you know, get the scene calm down to some level. Mm-hmm. And if that officer believes somebody with a psychology or counseling background might be helpful, then they'll call us in. So usually the mm-hmm. scenes are pretty safe. Mm-hmm. Now, when it comes to the negotiating thing, it's a little more sporty. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad I got some training and experience before kind of diving into that stuff.
And what exactly, when you talk about negotiations, are we talking hostage negotiations? What kind of negotiations are you talking about?
Yeah, our negotiating team responds to a variety of calls. It could be somebody wanting to commit suicide. They might be barricaded in the house by themselves, or they might be on an overpass wanting to jump. We do have those hostage situations, which are extremely dangerous and unpredictable. It really covers the gamut. Could be a kidnapping, though I've never worked a kidnapping. Any kind of situation where we might be able to resolve this without force, be it an officer who's trained in how to talk or a mental health professional kind of assisting with the situation.
Well, you know, as you're talking about that, I was thinking, you know, when we talk about people who say they want to commit suicide, or if they're telling you that they want to do it, do they usually want to do it, or is it just a cry for help?
Everything seems to fall on a continuum in my line of work. Mm-hmm. And I've seen people who were quite quiet and not saying anything who ended up hurting themselves. And then people who were very boisterous, and really it was sometimes a cry for help. And in a couple situations, not the norm, of course, it was in some ways a manipulation. So there's all sorts of different motivations. And it's really hard to get up to speed when you're just walking up to some stranger on an overpass.
Well, has anybody on the overpass ever jumped? I mean, have you had losses with all this?
My very first one, the gentleman seemed to be not toying with it, but considering it in such a way that he started to lean backwards. And I was looking at him, and he was looking at me as he kind of leaned backwards. And then as he lost his balance, he tried to grab on to the railing and missed. Now, he didn't die. He fell about 25 feet and fell right next to the ambulance we had parked underneath the overpass. Right on the pavement.
Oh.
So he broke his hip.
He's lucky that's all, huh?
Yeah, exactly. And for that to be my first experience with that kind of thing, it was a little jarring.
And you went back for more. Yeah.
Right. And I think that just speaks to my level of sanity.
Yeah. Well, I think it's an interesting calling to want to do this kind of thing. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. I think that you have to be a calm person. You have to not, lose your cool, obviously. What do you tell people? I mean, what is it that you're helping people learn from this book that you've learned, that you've told people in the field? I mean, who is this book for, and what is the main message, I guess?
Yeah, for me, I'm an educator at heart, so I would like people to understand a little better something that is not ordinary or common. I think a lot of people will see police activity and yellow tape and all that kind of stuff, but they're really left to make assumptions about what's going on down the street. And so my hope was to tell these stories in such a way that was not only educational, but interesting. And then hopefully a byproduct being for people who wanted to get into this field, they would get a little more training and experience just by reading a book before they had to dive in. Because I remember what it was like to just dive in.
Yeah, it does help to get anecdotal advice and experience. But I'm curious, you said stories. Is there a story that you like to share that really is something that would pique people's interest?
Oh boy. We were talking about the first calls, and how, at least for me, they were kind of awkward. And my very first negotiation was with a subject who barricaded himself in a house and was making lots of threats and, you know, just trying to, it seemed after the fact, to manipulate the people around him. He seemed quite angry. And I got a call at home in the middle of the night from an officer, and he said, "Hey, the chief of patrol would like you to call inside and keep this guy busy while SWAT gets set up. Would you mind calling inside?" And I'm like, "What in the world? How did I get into this?"
Right.
And I didn't have any negotiator training. I simply had my counseling background at that point. So I made the phone call, and the gentleman was quite angry, and right off the bat, he hit me with a question that I did not expect. He yelled at me and wanted to know where I got my counseling license from.
Oh.
I was like, "What in the world?" Uh-huh. And so I gave him a quick answer. I was like, "Is there anything you want to talk about? Like, what's going on?" And he was like, and he wasn't satisfied with my answer, and he just kept F-bombing me and yelling at me and eventually hung up on me. And so it didn't feel quite successful.
Did you ask him what would have been a better answer for that? You
know? Yeah, I never got a chance to because, you know, at that time the mentality was a little more tactical. And so once the SWAT team got set up and it didn't seem that this man was interested in being reasoned with, you know, they broke out the window and they took him into custody, and that was that. So no one really talked to the man after the fact. He was, you know, drunk and belligerent and all the rest of it.
Probably didn't remember even, huh?
No, probably not. And it seemed like really it was about power and control and, you know, exercising his will and trying to push somebody else around. So the officers at the scene, I imagine, were not very interested in asking him, how could we have helped you better? Because he wasn't really interested in help.
Yeah. Well, do they make you wear a bulletproof vest or anything? Are you getting close enough that you have to worry about that kind of stuff?
I do have a bulletproof vest and a helmet, mostly because it makes me feel cool.
It does, I bet.
But I'd rather be safe than sorry, because right. I am kind of, there have been a few times where I've been very close to where possibly shots could be fired and make it to where we are. So, and, you know, in today's society, you never know which way the bullets are going to come from.
Yeah, you know, it's such a crazy time, and you're talking about, you know, right now we've got these race riots, we got COVID crisis. What are the people coming to you to help with right now? Is it COVID? Is it race riots? Is it something else?
You know, the race riots, they have affected the morale of some of the police officers. Most of the people who come to me for just straight counseling are actually in law enforcement. Mm-hmm. And then I got a lot of friends in law enforcement too. So it's a lot of kind of like moral support. Hey, we're starting to feel like everybody hates us and wants us dead. Help me sort through that. And I think a lot of people don't really connect that a police officer could actually be afraid.
Yeah, I imagine they must be.
Right. I saw an officer in his riot gear, and he had a little patch on his vest. Stop screaming at me. I'm scared too.
I like that.
Yeah.
Well, you know, people only see from their vantage point. You know, if you're the bad guy, the cop's a bad guy. If you're in need of help, they're the good guy. And that's a very challenging thing. And I don't know. I mean, of course, there are police officers that do bad things, and
of course,
but that doesn't mean everybody's doing that. So is there education that you're dealing with the public right now, with, you know, understanding what the police are going through? I mean, I'm just curious if you're involved in any of that.
Yeah, you know, that was part of the reason for writing these stories down and writing these books. And then I often get to go out and speak various places, spoken at the hospital, community events, things like that. And I usually get those initial, I'm kind of afraid, help me understand why I shouldn't be afraid of the cops kind of questions. And then, of course, the anecdotal stories about, hey, this happened and here's how I perceived it. Do you have anything to add to that? And usually there's an educational component. Well, the officer did it this way because this is how they're trained, and officer safety dictates that they need to do this, this, and this. And when you explain that to somebody, usually they're like, oh, that makes more sense. Okay, I feel better.
Well, you know, it's interesting you bring that up, because you and I are both white, right? And and I've had Vernice Armour on my show, who's worked as a police officer, she's black. And she said when she trained as a police officer, they actually taught them to do that knock them out maneuver where you could potentially kill somebody. They don't want you to, of course, but you don't know. So do we need to retrain, rethink how we're training?
Oh, boy, that is a tough question. I think I'm going to kind of punt and say the training that officers are focusing on may need adjustment, but they still need to have the skills necessary to save their life and the life of an innocent third party. So there are those instances where a seemingly disturbing level of force would be necessary. I think the hard part and the debate is about when and how, and, you know, that individual officer's decision making.
It didn't, when I talked to her, it didn't sound like they really saw it as something that could lead to death, or, you know what I mean? They're just mm-hmm. thinking it's subduing or whatever. I don't know if there's the training level involved that maybe needs to be involved in
yes.
how to subdue somebody. But, you know, it's just such a horrible time in our world right now, because, you know, our perceptions of who the good guys and bad guys are different based on our vantage point. And that was interesting to me, just because I'm writing about perception. If you're white, your perception might be different than if you're black, and how you've lived your life. Do you think this is all shedding a light that needed to be shined on a situation? I'm just curious in your perspective of that.
Yes. Of course, I'm a fan of education, dialogue, illumination. Let's all get on the same page about how we want to do this. And again, it's ugly when you have one person who is making bad decisions and another person has to respond to it. And so society, I can see why they kind of react like, oh, that's really ugly, I don't like it. But at the same time, when you understand all the factors involved, sometimes there's not another good option. War is ugly, you know, combat is ugly. And when you see that on the civil level, it's really hard to digest or even comprehend, wow, why would that be necessary?
Yeah, it's just, it is a very challenging situation. And I think that what you're talking about is what probably comes up in a lot of court cases. Do you do any court cases where you have to testify at all?
Oh, no, knock on wood. And if I get called to testify because of this conversation, I'm going to have to come back and yell at you.
Well, hopefully you won't have that happen, and I don't want you yelling at me. But I I've had a few experts though that do a lot of this court testifying, and it is interesting to hear, you know, what it is. I mean, people are experts, and you know, and but of course it's from their own vantage point and their perception. It's just, there's no really good answer in some of these really tough situations where everybody's going to feel like they've lost something in negotiation, right?
Yes, I think that's right.
So how do you get them past that sense that they've lost something?
Well, in particular, what do you mean by they lost something?
Well, if in negotiation, I have to give up this for you to get that. You know what I mean? You're all losing a little bit it's never really feels like a total win-win. You know what I mean?
Right. And so to have that longer term goal or that broader perspective, though, it feels like I'm losing in this point. In the long term, this is probably the best thing. I mean, we see it in parenting all the time. Mm-hmm. I know you don't want to go to bed right now, but if you get some sleep, you'll probably feel like a normal person in the morning. My 2-year-old's not going to understand that at all.
Right.
Yeah. And yeah, go ahead.
No, I'm interested in those kinds of, I guess the stories that you tell in your book are what interests me, because I think that you've probably had perpetrators and victims and law enforcement and families and all. See it from everybody's perspective, right?
That's exactly right. And that's kind of the weird position I have on the team. I end up being the guy who kind of is stepping back from the situation and trying to look at all the angles, all the perspectives, everybody's point of view, to try and find some safe synthesis that gets us all to a good place.
How do you determine that common ground? I mean, if it's so different, and how do you get them? How do you open their eyes to that? You know what I mean?
Oh my gosh. Yeah. You know, cause sometimes, police officers can get pretty entrenched and pretty black and white in their thinking. And so to try and speak their language and find, you know, something that's important to them, you know, you could have some commander who's never been to a SWAT call out in 10 years. And he shows up and he's, you know, hard and fast and let's kick doors. And to speak his language, like, yeah, I don't think we've done that in 10 years. And here's why. And here's the liability associated with that. And then with our guy on the inside, you know, we don't want to have to wreck your house just because you're drunk and firing off rounds into your ceiling.
Yeah.
I know you're upset right now, but can we kind of look beyond your emotion in this moment and kind of think about how not to wreck your house?
Is it all men, or do you deal with a lot of women too?
The incidents with women is, in my anecdotal view, slowly on the rise.
Like what kind of things?
Well, the last person that I talked to who wanted to jump off a bridge was female.
What's usually the reason? Or is there not one common reason?
Yeah, again, there's not one common reason. Sometimes people have psychiatric conditions. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people, it's life stressors. Sometimes people are high on meth and they're not thinking straight. It can be all over the place. And it's, I like problem solving. And so to show up on an overpass and not have any idea about a person and try and get from there to some sort of peaceful resolution is really quite a puzzle to figure out.
So how do you start? Do you try to be their friend? I mean, what's the beginning of that?
Yeah, listening is the beginning. Mm-hmm. And trying to illustrate, model, show that I'm truly interested in your perspective and what's going on with you, if you'd be willing to talk to me. And my hope is that through that, we might actually be able to find some option or some help that you hadn't thought of because of your emotional state and, you know, your desperation.
Well, you know, I mentioned you wrote the book, When Every Word Counts. Well, what words count the most?
Oh, man. Right at the beginning, that first impression when somebody is in deep crisis, be it anger or depression or whatever, that first impression, your tone, your use of language. I just mentioned the phrase, would you be willing to talk to me? That is not a phrase that naturally comes out of the mouth of a police officer. Mm-hmm. Usually they phrase it something like, hey, I need you to talk to me.
Yeah.
That's a very different approach than, right. Hey, would you be willing? And, you know,
all
the.
No? What do you do?
Then I have to be patient.
Do they say no?
Oh, my goodness. Yes.
and so you have to keep asking that throughout late, you know, in different ways. Is it after you calm them down or what other things do you ask them?
Well, I'm thinking in particular, we had a 7-hour call out with a gentleman. It was midnight. It was 20 degrees. He was naked on an overpass. He was high on meth with a history of schizophrenia and probably a personality disorder.
Yeah.
And that conversation was incredibly slow and required 7 hours worth of patience on our part.
Wow.
Yeah. And so there
well?
Were, it did end well. In my view, we were able to set things up to where he saw that it was in his best interest to go to the ambulance we had parked nearby. But that took a lot of patience and pauses. Like there was 15 minutes where we just stood there and he just stared at us. But in that 15 minutes of quiet, he started to learn something about us that seemed to help us later.
And what did he learn? To trust you? Is that what you mean?
Yeah. When I say, I'm not going to come grab you. Mm-hmm. And he curses at me and says, don't talk to me. And I just stand there. I don't leave. I don't rush him and I don't talk to him. He starts to learn something about me.
So who talked next, you or did he?
Usually it was us.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, we don't typically negotiate alone. So there was six of us up there kind of in a group. But yeah, eventually we talk again, just kind of put up out there, like in this case, hey, buddy, I can see that your feet are black from frostbite and I'm worried about you losing your feet. Can we go to the hospital? Just that. Just inserting something that might be outside of his frame of reference.
Is it part you're also waiting out the drugs kind of come out of your system after 7 hours? I mean, does he calm down because of that to some extent?
I would say in regular cases, yes. But in this case, when the drugs went away, then his schizophrenia was more present.
Huh. And, so you're dealing with multiple people throughout the time you're talking to this one person, basically, right?
Exactly. We went from meth-induced psychosis to schizophrenia-induced psychosis.
Wow. Does that scare you to know that they know who you are now?
I'm not a big fan of being afraid. He doesn't know my name. If I ran into him in the parking lot, you know, he might recognize me. Usually, there isn't a reason to be afraid of people in those situations after they resolve. So I haven't had that yet, but yeah. I can use my imagination.
Yeah, I can. Yeah. Well, and then in today's other situation, we have COVID situation. Are you dealing with any of the crisis or dealing with people having difficulty dealing with that, or is that outside your purview?
No, well, I think it is a factor that leads people to things like depression and suicidal thoughts. Mm-hmm. So I would say I deal with it once it gets to that point.
I see. And yeah, you're probably seeing more of that.
Yes.
Are people just losing it more now because of this?
Yeah, I think we're seeing an uptick in rates of depression and suicide attempts for sure.
This is the craziest year ever, and I can't even imagine. And it's really great that there are people like you who help people when they get to their wits' end, because, you know, you need the reasoning at that point, and it's good to hear that they're calling in people to do that. And I think a lot of people will probably be very interested in your fight or flight, or even When Every Word Counts books that you've written, and if they probably want to know how to follow you and learn more. So is there a site or a social media or something you'd like to share?
Sure. I have a website with the books on it and a little background about me, drandyyoung.com, drandyyoung.com. And that's probably the best way to get connected.
Okay. Well, that's awesome. Well, I hope everybody takes some time to check out your work and your books. And thank you so much for sharing. This is really fascinating, Andy. I really enjoyed our conversation.
I did too. Thank you very much for this.
Oh, you're welcome. It was fun. And we will be back right after this message.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, I'd really like to thank Rebecca and Andy for being my guests today. We get so many great guests on this show. If you've missed any past episodes, please go to drdianehamilton.com. You can check out the episodes on the blog if you want to read them. You could also listen to them there. But we're also on iTunes, iHeart, and on all the podcast stations, basically. And also, the AM/FM stations we play on are all listed on the site. So I hope you check it out, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.